So our first speaker tonight is Sara Russell. She's a nutritional therapy practitioner who resides in Italy. Sara maintains a private practice offering consultations worldwide via phone and video calling to clients, as well as providing consultation services to health practitioners dealing with complex cases. She particularly enjoys supporting the health of families across the generations and specializes in nutritional support during the preconception period, pregnancy, and childhood, when the impact of heavy metal toxicity is critical. And there you are. Please welcome Sara.
Oh, you got that.
I have. Thank you. Hello. Thank you so much for inviting me to speak this evening. Thank you for the presentation, Randy. I also would like to thank my co-author on a recent Mercury paper that we published in the Townsend Letter, Chris Homey. Thank you for being here today. And thank you for writing the paper, because it definitely could not be what it is without us working together. Thank you, Nori, for coming with us from Berkeley and being her driver. I came all the way from Italy without a car. So I come from faraway places. All right. So my talk this evening, the focus is going to be on the effects of mercury exposure throughout the lifespan. It's a big topic, so think of it a little bit as a survey presentation. The first thing to be said is that essentially there is a cumulative effect of mercury not just throughout our individual lifespan, but it is also cumulative across generations. So it is passed from mother to child in utero, and most of us are born with some amount of mercury toxicity that we have acquired from our mother via placental exchange. Mercury is an exceptionally insidious toxicant that can cause or contribute to most chronic illnesses. We'll talk a little bit more about that later on. This does not mean that mercury causes all chronic illnesses. Once you start learning about mercury, you may imagine that everybody you know has all their health problems are caused by mercury. That's usually not the case. That's just you being aware. Congratulations on your awareness. It has to all kind of be put in context. So mercury usually is a significant piece of most people's health problems, but it's never the whole story. It is a very, very important part in the story. So one of the things that I see in my nutritional practice is clients come to me with complex cases and unsolved issues. And often nobody has ever asked them if they have a history of amalgams in their mouth. Nobody has ever asked them if their mother had amalgams when she was pregnant with them. Nobody has ever asked them about their vaccine history or about their fish consumption. So I may be the first practitioner who addresses the mercury piece, and it often is a huge unexplained aspect of a person's health picture. Diagnosis of chronic mercury toxicity is typically very difficult, because the body's natural defenses may mask or delay symptoms. This is one of the reasons why it's difficult. There are other reasons, including testing, and we will talk about that as well. So the developmental window from conception, really we could say preconception, because of the epigenetic piece, and we'll talk about that more in a little bit. From conception through early childhood is one of extreme vulnerability to mercury. So the baby's developing brain and neurological system are exceptionally vulnerable to the accumulation and effects of mercury toxicity. Mercury toxicity creates a need for extra nutrition, both because there is damage that has been done by mercury, and to provide ample enzyme cofactors, which can help get blocked enzymes up and moving again. Of course, the third reason, which we'll talk about more later, is that mercury specifically depletes certain nutrients because of its mechanism of toxicity. Symptoms may manifest differently in different people, depending on exposure, lifestyle, genetics, epigenetics, and micronutrient status. So there isn't one single symptom that you have to look for. There is a Mercury type of personality, and we'll get into that in just a little bit. But it's hard to diagnose, and this is one of the many reasons why often it goes undiagnosed. So I hinted at this earlier, long latencies may occur with onset of symptoms, sometimes happening months or years after exposure has ceased. So it's not linear, because we all have a different degree of robustness in terms of our body's ability to withstand Mercury, because we have a unique micronutrient status, for example, or a unique set of antioxidant capacities. So not everybody will respond in the same way or in the same time frame. Erethism is the term that is used to refer to a constellation of personality traits that is often seen in people with Mercury toxicity. Don't assume that this is an exclusionary characteristic. So just because you don't present like the Mad Hatter in Alice in Wonderland does not mean that you do not have a Mercury problem. Erethism comes from the word that means to redden, and it involves a constellation of personality traits, including timidity, shyness, diffidence, contentiousness, insecurity, bluntness, rigidity, excitability, and hypersensitivity to criticism and sensory stimulation. So these are people who, when I talk to parents of Mercury toxic children, the quick phrase we use is annoying and annoyed. That pretty much covers many of the bases there. To start answering the question that was posed earlier, what are the most common sources of mercury exposure? We'll get into some obscure ones too for the nerdy people out in the audience. The public receives mixed messages from health authorities and agencies my title of the slide is a little bit, I'm ahead of myself. I'm excited about the exposure sources, but we're not there yet. This is still an introduction. We receive mixed messages from health authorities and agencies about the risks of mercury from routine exposures involving dentistry, fish, and vaccines. So one of the reasons why it's so hard to have mercury toxicity recognized and acknowledged openly is that much exposure is iatrogenic, so medically and dentally inflicted. For most people, the major sources of mercury exposure are elemental mercury vapor from dental amalgams. This is really the primary exposure source for most people living today. Just because you don't have dental amalgams or haven't ever had them placed in your mouth does not mean that you do not have mercury that comes from the dental amalgams from preceding generations. These have been used for the past 150 years, and unless your mother was born 200 years ago, chances are you got some, past generation mercury when you were still in utero. This is not something that will be in your baby book. It's just not going to be there. You should ask your mom or someone who may know. Methylmercury from dietary fish is another common source of exposure. How much you're getting depends on how much fish you're eating, what types of fish you're eating, how long-lived they are, and where they're being fished from. So this could be a talk all in itself, but it isn't going to be that talk. Ethylmercury in certain vaccines provides smaller amounts of mercury at this point, but these can be highly toxic during the vulnerable window of gestation and early childhood. Depending on the adult, it can also be very, some people are incredibly vulnerable to mercury toxicity from vaccines, even as adults. How many of you saw the movie Trace Amounts? Raise your hand. So some people, if you haven't, please go watch the movie. Not right now, but sometime in the near future. It is an important movie, and because it talks about the significance of mercury exposure and some of its implications. The the person who created the film, I can't remember his name right at the moment. Eric Gladen. Thank you, Chris. Actually was seriously damaged by the mercury in a DPT vaccine. So he got injured while doing some outdoor work, and he got, he was told he had to get a tetanus vaccine, and the 25 milligrams of mercury, I'm sorry, micrograms, not milligrams, micrograms of mercury in that vaccine really had an incredibly powerful negative effect on him. And that spurred the documentary project of and his quest to find out what happened and why it happened and how it's happening. It didn't just happen to him. It has happened to many people and still is happening. So amalgam fillings are 50% elemental mercury. That's a lot. They have been in use for the past 150 years. So if you have amalgams in your mouth and you are pregnant, you will be passing on part of your mercury burden to your unborn child or children during pregnancy. So each generation accumulates some of the previous generation's mercury toxicity. It's just a mother to child passing on of the actual physical burden, because it is from the mother's body through the placenta into the fetus. When we talk about epigenetic toxicity, both the maternal and paternal mercury toxicity has an impact. Even people who have never had amalgams placed often have amalgam-based mercury for this reason. The World Health Organization estimates that the typical absorbed dose of mercury from amalgams in people who have them is 1 to 22 micrograms per day. So that is like getting, if you are in the upper range of that, that is basically like getting a mercury-containing vaccine every day. That's a lot of mercury. With most values in the range of 1.5 micrograms per day. So the upper range, if you have a large number of fillings, 10, 12, you chew gum, you grind your teeth, you could be absorbing up to 100 micrograms per day of mercury. That is a lot of mercury. Certain types of electromagnetic radiation, including cell phones, magnetic resonance imaging, so MRI machines, can increase the release of mercury vapor from dental amalgams, according to some research on the topic. So they studied the level and rate of off-gassing in people with amalgam fillings, and it did increase in the presence of exposure to these electromagnetic radiation sources. So unsafe amalgam removal can cause acute exposure to mercury vapor. This is why biological dentists using appropriate methods of amalgam removal are sought out by astute consumers such as yourselves. The International Academy of Oral Medicine and Toxicology, the IAOMT, which many of you are probably familiar with, is a professional dental organization that has developed a protocol and training program that attempts to minimize the exposure to mercury vapor to the patient, to the dentist, and to the staff during amalgam removal. The term mercury-free dentist is used a lot. Usually that refers to a dentist who will not place mercury in your mouth. If they remove mercury from your mouth, their office is not mercury-free, obviously. But they are much less likely than a non-mercury-free dentist, a non-IAOMT dentist, a non-biological dentist, to be very nonchalant and careless, so what happens a lot of the time in traditional dental offices is that amalgam will just get spilled and no special precautions are taken in terms of cleaning up and removing that off-gassing from the environment. And there is no regulation that forces a dental office that closes or moves to notify the next tenant that you know, that there was mercury used in the building, or that, you know, possibly mercury spilled in the building. So that is, you know, it's a source of environmental exposure that has consequences in terms of public health, broadly speaking. Removal of amalgam should be timed so as to avoid the 12 to 18 months preceding conception, as well as pregnancy and breastfeeding. So, you know, if you are a pregnant woman and you have amalgams and you're in a panic because you don't want to pass on your dental mercury to your baby, the absolute worst thing you can do is go out and get that dental mercury removed during your pregnancy. Wait till you're done breastfeeding and stay as calm as possible, because panic has never helped anybody detoxify properly, or limited exposure to the next generation for that matter. Fish. The most contaminated fish are large, long-lived fish high in the food chain. So the longer lived they are, the bigger they are, the more they weigh, the longer they're, they've been around, the higher the content of mercury. Mercury levels in fish vary widely by species and by individual, ranging from less than 0.1 part per million. For salmon and sardines, this is, you know, it's an average figure, to more than one part per million, so 10 times as much. For some samples of tilefish, shark, swordfish, and king mackerel, a typical serving of fish may contain anywhere from a few micrograms to more than 100 micrograms of mercury. So that is a really broad range. You could go from, you know, like 1 to 2 micrograms per serving to over 100 micrograms per serving. I did have a client who came to me. She was on a very restricted diet due to food sensitivities. And she was only eating 4 or 5 foods when she initially contacted me. And one of those was salmon, and she had a very high mercury burden. There was some amalgam exposure involved as well, but definitely, you know, it's, if you just eat the low mercury fish, but you're eating them every day, cumulatively, you could be piling on a lot of mercury into your system. What you decide to do about fish consumption, so there's no easy answer. I can't tell you whether you should eat fish or what kinds you should eat or how much. It depends on a variety of factors. Many people prefer lower mercury fish, such as wild caught Alaskan salmon, wild caught sardines, herring, anchovies, you know, just other small fish. Small mackerel is considered a low mercury fish. King mackerel is considered a high mercury fish. So don't think that all mackerel is alike. It isn't. Fish during pregnancy, lactation, and early childhood, most people understand that on the one hand, the omega-3 fatty acids are really important for fetal brain development. On the other hand, you know, mercury exposure is particularly damaging during this developmental window, and for this reason, because developing fetuses, babies, and young children are most at risk, the EPA and the FDA maintain guidelines regarding fish consumption during during pregnancy, during breastfeeding, and during early childhood. You know, if you know someone who is receiving donor breast milk, one thing you could say that, you know, recommend that you, that they ask their donor, if they know who that is, do you have amalgam fillings in your mouth? Do you eat fish? You may then, you know, want to screen breast milk donors according to that criterion, as well as other things, you know, such as what medications they take. Because if, you know, if you're feeding a baby donor breast milk that is high in mercury, that is not necessarily better than some other options out there. All the pros and cons have to be weighed against each other. That being said, the consensus is that if you are a mother and you are lactating your baby, that it is better to feed your baby your own milk than to switch them to a formula. Of course, you want to take precautions. You want to avoid chelating substances or chewing lots of gum or grinding your teeth or doing other things, you know, lots of EMF exposure during breastfeeding. So the breastfeeding has value. It's not just about what's in the milk and what isn't in the milk. It's beyond that. So it's a complicated situation, like many other things relating to mercury. The list of fish species most dangerous to this vulnerable population, according to the EPA and FDA, includes king mackerel, big eye tuna, marlin. I honestly don't even know what fish that is. Orange. Okay, thank you. So I have it twice with two different names for good measure. Orange roughy, shark, swordfish, striped bass, and tilefish from the Gulf of Mexico. Vaccines. So there isn't a regulatory safety standard for ethyl mercury, which is the type of mercury in vaccines. Not all vaccines have ethyl mercury. We'll talk about that in a little bit. There are regulatory standards for methyl mercury. There is no reason to give any credibility to the myth that methyl mercury is much more dangerous and ethyl mercury is easily cleared from the body. It will literally disappear from the bloodstream, but that's because mercury is so toxic that it rapidly leaves the bloodstream and gets deposited typically in the brain. So just because you can't measure it in a recently vaccinated child's blood does not mean that it has exited their body. So we were just talking in the car ride over here with Nori, and she mentioned that that the studies that have measured urine, sweat, and fecal excretion of heavy metals post-vaccine shows that this is not being excreted. So it is accumulating in the body. Approximate mercury content. So the 1990s era vaccine generation, it's called the thimerosal generation. Kids who were born in the 1990s really got the highest dose of ethyl mercury from vaccines, historically that so far. So these were phased out really starting in 2000, but they weren't entirely gone until about 2004. DTP and DTaP, four doses of vaccines totaling 100 micrograms. The Hib, Haemophilus influenza B, four doses totaling 100 micrograms. Hepatitis B, three doses totaling 37.5 micrograms. The multi-dose influenza vaccines given annually, that's 25 extra micrograms per year. The tetanus vaccine is 25 micrograms. The first 6 months of life, babies vaccinated according to the CDC schedule with all the recommended vaccines, they accumulated 187.5 micrograms in 6 months. That is a lot of mercury. That is over, that is just over 1 microgram per day of life. Of course, if the baby was premature, the effects of the mercury toxicity were even greater. Vaccine ethyl mercury can be compared to the EPA's safe reference dose for methyl mercury of 0.1 microgram per kilogram, so 2.2 pounds of body weight per day for chronic exposure, equivalent to about 0.3 micrograms per day for a newborn and 0.6 micrograms per day for a six-month-old baby. This level is very lax, and it is a lot lower than what the thimerosal generation accumulated over... the 187.5 micrograms that they accumulated over the first 6 months of life is way over that reference range. So this guideline is hypothetical based on the methyl mercury, which is the only regulated form. What we need to keep in mind is that methyl mercury is ingested mercury, and so the defense mechanisms that we have in our gut, including metallothionein, are protective. We don't have that same protection when we inject mercury as part of a vaccine into the tissue directly. So probably the guidelines should be more stringent, not less. Between 1999 and 2004, thimerosal began to be phased out of pediatric vaccines. Thimerosal continues to be used in the preparation of some of these vaccines, not all of them. So the live or, you know, kind of inactivated vaccines do not use mercury because it would kill the microorganisms because it's very toxic. It is used as a preservative in the non-live vaccines, such as the multi-dose DTaP, used in the preparation of some of these vaccines. So it is used in the preparation process, and it is then, to a great extent, filtered out. This applies to the multi-dose DTaP and the DTaP-Hib combination vaccines, and remains in trace amounts in the end product. This is the CDC's page where they describe this process uses the term trace amounts, and that is where the movie Trace Amounts got its title from, because trace amounts are still, you know, consequential, even though they may not be listed on a label. Influenza vaccines administered to pregnant women may be a source of thimerosal to the fetus. Thimerosal is just really ethyl mercury. The flu vaccine remains a significant source of mercury exposure during gestation, infancy, and early childhood. Obviously to those children and infants who are being vaccinated with it. So for example, in California, I believe it was in the fall of 2015, the governor signed a special letter saying that because they had run out of the mercury-free flu vaccines, that vulnerable populations could be liberally injected with the mercury-containing flu vaccine, even though that was not the protocol. It's just an easy get around because if you don't make enough mercury-free vaccines for the population to whom it is being recommended very adamantly with a lot of propaganda, then of course that's a sure way to ensure that a great part of the vulnerable population is still getting injected with 25 micrograms of thimerosal, of ethyl mercury, every time they get a vaccine. So when 50 micrograms of thimerosal contain 25 micrograms of ethyl mercury, to clarify. Okay, partial list of other exposures. Some of these are a little more obscure than others. Others are very pedestrian, everyday objects. Compact fluorescent lamps, pretty much by the time we phased out those old mercury thermometers that we were all told were so unsafe, which they were, compact fluorescent lamps arrived in our homes. Those contain a lot of mercury. When they break, they release that mercury, and it remains in the environment for a very long time. So again, you could break a compact fluorescent lamp when you're moving out of your old apartment. The new tenant will have no idea that that happened. And you will be exposed for the next 3 years to high levels of mercury vapor in your environment. That's just not really great news. Some over-the-counter products, such as nasal and eardrops, hemorrhoid creams, et cetera. Some cosmetics, most notably mascara. So the Minamata Treaty that regulated the use of mercury as a preservative in consumer products a number of years ago, what that did was it allowed for certain consumer products to contain certain amounts of mercury, often without that being required to be listed on the label. So it is optional for manufacturers to list in cosmetic products mercury when it is used at less than 65 parts per million in a product such as mascara. So just because it's not listed as an inactive or an active ingredient does not mean that it's not there. Call the manufacturer and ask. There are lines of cosmetics that are, that triple test for different toxic metals. The best way to avoid heavy metal exposure from cosmetics is just not to use them. It's pretty simple. If you do like your makeup, then look into a clean makeup line. Occupational exposure, dental offices, gold mining. The gold country is in, here in California is still absolutely full of mercury from the gold mining years, and that has polluted the air, soil, and water and made the fish unsafe to eat. High pressure gauges, if you work in a place that uses those, chemistry labs, obviously, you know, even hobby chemistry sets that contain elemental mercury. Those are a lot of fun.
I just wanted to mention that we have a cement production startup. We have a cement production facility in the hills of Cupertino that every time they bake off the CO2 from the limestone, it releases all the mercury that's stored in the rock that they're digging out of the ground. And so just living in Cupertino can be a significant exposure.
Yeah. Yeah, cement plants, unfortunately, are, they're not on this list, but yes, they are. And thank you for pointing that out, an important source of mercury exposure. So also geographic proximity to crematoria, coal-fired power plants, and present and past gold mining areas. This is a partial list of exposure sources that are not currently legal in the US, but some of them may still exist. You know, you may have some old stuff lying around. Teething powders, so calomel, merbromin, under the name of mercurochrome. Some of you may remember that it was used as an antiseptic. My parents really did not, they didn't care about antiseptics, so I at least was spared that. My husband had, his mother was a nurse, so he got sprayed very liberally with every little scrape and scratch with mercurochrome. So we all have varying degrees of exposure to that stuff. Discontinued in 1998 in the US. In Europe, I believe, in 2000. Mercury thermometers, again, in the US, these were banned for manufacture in 1998. Of course, they did not send the police around home to home looking for your old mercury thermometers. Some of you may still have them in your house. I had a mercury thermometer in my house in 1998. I remember that. Contact lens solutions. Less common sources of mercury exposure include cinnabar or vermilion, which is a mineral used in art, including tattoos. I seriously doubt that tattoo artists today in the US are actually using cinnabar, but you can, you know, ask. I have not gone around and surveyed them all. Jewelry. And some Chinese medicine formulations that are not actually legal for manufacture in or importation to the US, but they are nonetheless available. I did inquire amongst my acupuncturist friends. I just asked them all, you know, are these specific formulas that contain cinnabar available? And one of them thought that I was actually looking for a formula for myself, and he told me where I could get it. So yes, it is available. But I won't tell you where to get it because I don't want you to be exposed to it. Some religious and folk healing rituals, including some Santeria rituals, use mercury. So it's sold in the little shops called botanicas in ethnic neighborhoods throughout the US. Chicago, I think, has about 50 of these shops. You know, many cities and towns with a significant Latin American population do sell this liberally, and kids play with it. It gets, you know, strewn about the house. Health departments in some states have gotten involved in printing pamphlets in Spanish for the education of the Latino population on the dangers of using these and suggesting alternatives that are still within the Santeria tradition. So things like, I believe, dragon's blood and some other alternatives that are still part of their roots but are not as dangerous to them, to other people who may walk into their house, or, you know, to future tenants. it will take a long time for that knowledge to sink in, because of course, you know, these are traditions which a lot of people are attached to. So preconception and epigenetic toxicity. So as I mentioned earlier, the developmental period spanning from conception through early childhood is a window of vulnerability in which both epigenetic and neurological damage can occur at exposures far lower than those known to cause toxicity in adults. So that is why pregnant women are advised to eat less fish than they may ordinarily do. If you are a pregnant woman or know a pregnant woman, you know, you may want to supplement with a good high quality heavy metals tested fish oil to get those omega-3 fatty acids that you want for your brain, for your baby's brain development, and eat you know, very little fish if you are looking to cut down on potential mercury exposure. Epigenetics refers to the alteration of gene expression, so turning genes on and off, usually via environmental factors, without alteration of the DNA nucleotide sequence itself. So this is something that you know, that affects our genetic expression very strongly. But when, you know, if you've ever done a 23andMe or any other kind of epigenetic, so single nucleotide polymorphism testing, then you know, you should be, you probably are aware that it doesn't mean that all of those polymorphisms are actually being expressed in the person who manifests them. So it is just something that is potentially an issue in the person. You have to then look at the context, at the history, and at the symptoms. Mercury is a potent epigenetic toxicant of alarming scope, with both direct and indirect expressions on gene, indirect effects on gene expression. I've kind of tried to simplify the mechanisms of epigenetic toxicity. Mercury directly targets the cysteine, so that's an amino acid, that compromises the DNA binding sites on most gene transcription factors. So it is toxic to DNA. Mercury targets the cysteine in DNA methyltransferase enzymes, which play a role in normal gene expression. So this is DNA methylation. Indirectly, mercury promotes severe oxidative stress, and early life stressors are known to induce changes in gene expression that set the stage for disease in later life. So a lot of you know, problems with blood sugar regulation, predisposition to diabetes, et cetera, to Alzheimer's, can definitely be contributed to by the severe oxidative stress of early life mercury exposure. So when either parent is exposed to mercury, even prior to conception, the child's own genetic expression can be affected. So the implications of epigenetic and prenatal toxicity. Epigenetic damage may range from mild to severe, and the resulting phenotype may include characteristics such as dental deformities, nearsightedness, myopia, asymmetries of the face, and disproportions of the body. By depleting micronutrient stores in the mother and developing fetus, mercury induces structural and functional damage throughout the body from conception onward, and postnatal exposure perpetuates that damage. How many of you are familiar with the Weston A. Price Association? Yeah, so Weston A. Price was, he was a dentist who went around, traveled around the world to different parts of the world where he found isolated cultures living away from the routes of commerce and the foods of commerce. And he compared the dental arches and facial features of people living in their, according to their traditional ways of living and eating in their traditional environment versus the same populations that were exposed to the foods of commerce and to modern life. What's really interesting is that many of the nutritional deficiencies that Weston A. Price describes in his work and in his photographs can be induced just by mercury exposure. So you take the standard American diet, you add mercury to the mix, and you have a really compounded synergistic effect of toxicity and nutrition depletion. By depleting micronutrient stores, so you know vitamins and minerals, amino acids and whatnot in the mother and developing fetus, mercury induces structural and functional damage throughout the body from conception onward, and postnatal exposure perpetuates that damage. So this is why this talk is called Mercury Effects of Mercury Exposure Throughout the Lifespan. So the level of genetic and epigenetic susceptibility to mercury toxicity is variable according to many different things that cannot always be pinpointed, labeled, or categorized neatly. Sometimes we can't really nail it down. Several common genetic variants that convey increased susceptibility to mercury toxicity have been documented in human studies. It is incredibly likely that hundreds of additional variants are likely to exist. This is an emerging field of study. And remember, not that much research is poured into mercury toxicity awareness. Mercury attacks the sulfur and proteins, and since the body has tens of thousands of genetically determined sulfur-containing proteins, many of these are likely to include variants that contribute to susceptibility to mercury exposure. Candidate genes are involved not only in methylation and detoxification, so you know the glutathione transferase enzyme, most people know about that, is a selenium-dependent enzyme that is incredibly important for detoxification of all kinds of toxicants, including mercury. So once mercury impairs that, it's harder and harder for mercury to get detoxified. It's a vicious cycle. In vitamin, so these genes are involved not only in methylation and detoxification, but also in vitamin and mineral, which are enzyme cofactors. So in absorption, in transport of these nutrients, and in metabolism, broadly construed. So people who are exposed to large amounts of mercury and have impaired detoxification mechanisms or severely depleted antioxidant and nutritional stores could present metabolically as either overweight or underweight, depending on whether the digestive distress piece, digestion distress, and you know severe malnourishment prevails. Of course, you can see malnourishment even in overweight and obese people, or whether blood sugar dysregulation prevails, which often leads to insulin resistance and type 2 diabetes or metabolic syndrome, and then type 2 diabetes. A few isolated court cases in the US and elsewhere in the world have recognized post facto that a limited number of well-documented genetic susceptibilities, including some mitochondrial disorders, have caused certain children to suffer permanent neurological damage. So the CDC list of precautions and contraindications to vaccination, for example, does not mention these genetic susceptibilities, mitochondrial disorders. It's just something that is acknowledged kind of case by case in the vaccine courts. So there isn't really any kind of protocol for pre-vaccine testing. It would not be comprehensive. So in a context where more and more states and countries are mandating vaccines as a condition to entry into daycare, preschool, public school, private school, the question really does pop up, you know, who is liable? Who can guarantee that a parent who is hesitant about the potential for vaccine damage and wanting answers, you know, that at least are descriptive of the child's risk factors? These are completely unanswered questions. There are functional medicine doctors who and naturopathic doctors who are out there doing the hard work of educating parents and running some of these tests in these cases and sometimes writing exemptions. But that is hard work that people are pioneering all on their own without the support of the CDC or any country behind them or any mainstream scientists for that matter. pregnancy. Fetal neurons are more sensitive to the toxic effects of mercury than any other cell type. Of course, you know, all types of neurons are sensitive to the toxic effects of mercury. Some of you may have seen the snail neuron video. Sound familiar?
Say the name again?
Yeah, the snail neuron video. Google it. There's a YouTube video out there that shows the way that snail neurons are
depolarized.
Yeah, in the presence of mercury exposure. Mercury from the mother's body crosses the placenta easily and effortlessly and accumulates in the fetus. So remember, we have detoxification pathways in the body. During pregnancy, the placenta is an exit route for toxins, and the baby is the end receiver of some of those toxicants that are excreted from the mother's body. Not a cheerful topic to think about, but something that is important, especially if you know someone who is struggling with infertility or frequent miscarriage. Part of the underlying causative picture could be an excessive accumulation of mercury in the body, mercury or other toxic metals, often mercury together with other toxic metals, because the synergistic effect is exponentially higher than otherwise. And postmortem human and animal studies reveal that the way that mercury crosses the placenta and accumulates in the fetus. There are also postmortem studies, on adults that show the level of damage done by mercury as it correlates in a dose-dependent manner with the number of amalgam fillings that the subject has. Mercury levels in amniotic fluid, cord blood, placental tissue, and breast milk are significantly associated in a dose-dependent manner with a number of maternal dental amalgams. So, yes, there is bio-individual variation, but statistically, if you take a broad population, the more maternal dental amalgam fillings there are, the more mercury will accumulate in the fetus and in the breast milk and in the placenta. Human and animal studies show increased rates of miscarriage, neonatal death, low birth weight, and developmental disorders associated with mercury exposure. And over the lifespan, mercury bioaccumulates over time. So the half-life of mercury in the brain is estimated to be about 26 years. That means if you have, X number of milligrams of mercury in your brain, it will take 26 years if you just don't do anything special for that to reduce to half that amount, even without additional exposures, which you certainly will have. This is why and how mercury bioaccumulates over the lifespan. The epigenetic vulnerability in utero exposure and postnatal exposure set up a vicious cycle of nutritional deficiencies and impaired detoxification. And this cycle, in turn, leads to further accumulation of mercury toxicity throughout the entire lifespan and then passed on, as I mentioned earlier, to the future generations. Until our society and legislation truly address the dangers of mercury and the sources of exposure in an honest and forthright fashion, which has not yet happened. Those of us who are active in the mercury issue have been waiting for a long time and have become, on occasion, quite discouraged by the lack of interest and action. Each generation will continue to become more toxic than the previous one, and that is not a pretty picture. So the change can start in grassroots, just person-to-person education and action, because we can't wait for that change to come from the top. The direction is just not, there's no sign that that's the direction that that our society is taking right now. This is a complicated, the issues of symptoms and illnesses associated with mercury is a complicated issue for any number of reasons. So, like I mentioned before, mercury can cause or contribute to most chronic illnesses. via nutrient depletion, epigenetic toxicity, enzyme impairment, and more. Usually it is not just mercury doing it. There is a context in which mercury is kind of facilitated in its toxic effects. You know, for some people, there is kind of a perfect storm of many different factors, and sometimes it will be, you know, the mercury toxicity will become a big problem in the face of, you know, of a one-time large exposure that adds to the previous exposure, you know, kind of like the straw that breaks the camel's back. Or it could be an ongoing low-dose exposure that maybe is never even identified. It could be, you know, mercury plus lead synergistically increasing each other's toxicity. It could be mercury exposure plus a toxic mold exposure. Lots of different factors can interact to magnify the effects of mercury, and it can make it really hard to really go and say, okay, it was the mercury that did that, and you pinpoint the time and date and a source. It's rarely really that simple. A lot of investigative work has to be done and a lot of connecting of the dots. The conditions that mercury can cause and or contribute to can also have other causes. So this is one reason why it is difficult in traditional medical diagnostics to recognize the role of mercury or even think about it as a possible contributing factor or causative factor in illness. So the illnesses that mercury can cause and contribute to are, for the most part, sort of non-specific. They don't have one causative factor. The time lag between exposure to mercury and the onset of symptoms varies from person to person and depends on, on the whole context. So it's difficult. So mercury is quicksilver. If you've ever seen elemental mercury, you know, maybe has come out of a broken thermometer or chemistry set, you know that it kind of slips away, changes shape. It does this in diagnostics too, in a way. That is symbolically how it works. Some factors that affect how long the latency period is between exposure and symptoms include epigenetic factors, the total allostatic load prior to exposure, so the overall, all those things that are contributing to the stress in the body. Most of us start out accumulating mercury, to some extent in utero, in variable amounts depending on maternal toxicity and the parents and the fetus's epigenetic status. In terms of nutritional status, the more robust it is, the longer it will take to deplete our natural defense system. So some people have a very good nutritional status and it takes them a really, really long time for the mercury to deplete those nutrients. Lucky them, unlucky them, because they may never pinpoint mercury as the exposure source. They may be in serious denial. You may say, oh gosh, Uncle Joe, you have 14 amalgam fillings in your mouth. I can see them. You just yawned. Maybe that's why you're having these problems. Oh no, I've had those, you know, for the past 60 years. They're not a problem. I just started being sick 2 years ago or 10 years ago or whatever. It's hard to attribute that to mercury toxicity, not just because of the latency, but also because we kind of get attached to things kind of being as they are. It's difficult to think, oh gosh, you know, for my health, I have to go out and change. I have to change the way I eat. I have to find a practitioner who can safely and appropriately remove my amalgam fillings. I have to trust someone with my health, with this balance and with this imbalance. So there are many reasons why we may have resistance. And then of course, in a society where our medical class is not informing us appropriately and accurately in terms of the dangers, then it's even harder to make these connections and to take action, because we get mixed messages from different places. Overall functional health status, so the more robust our functional health is, the more well-equipped we are to deal with any stressor, including toxic exposures. Mercury is often involved in the following illnesses. Again, it could have, you know, each of these illnesses could have other factors. Usually there is a combination of factors, and the list here is not complete. autism, ADHD, learning and cognitive difficulties throughout the lifespan, lead exposure. Please note that lead exposure can exacerbate mercury's cognitive effects tremendously. So mercury alone, say it's one, lead alone is one, mercury and lead together. So one plus one is not two, with mercury and lead it's 100. Autoimmune illnesses can definitely be caused by and or contributed to a great extent by mercury. Multiple sclerosis, Hashimoto's thyroiditis. Hashimoto's is an interesting case because almost every single person I've worked with Hashimoto's has a story of greater than average mercury burden. I see it a lot in women who are dentists or dental hygienists, daughters of and sometimes sons of dentists who spent a lot of time either helping out in the office or spent their afternoons after school just sitting there doing their homework and just breathing in the vapors. Rheumatoid arthritis, Meniere's disease, and so on and so forth. I think that as a society, we still have a long way to go in terms of acknowledging the role, not just of mercury, but of other toxicants with which it interacts. So one of the things that I've noticed in terms of increased rates of celiac disease is that, and many other chronic illnesses, especially in children, is the compounded effect of mercury exposure that has increased over time and glyphosate, so the active ingredient in Roundup. Those two together deplete nutrients, and I don't believe that there are any papers out there that talk about this specifically, but if you look at the studies separately on mercury on the one hand and glyphosate on the other, and you compare what nutrients they deplete and how they weaken gut barriers and how they can affect mitochondrial health and nutrients, it's really shocking. And I'm actually hoping that somebody someday will write, we'll do a good study on the compounded synergistic effects of mercury and glyphosate together, because I think that this is incredibly important in our understanding of why all of a sudden so many more people have celiac disease, so many more people have non-celiac gluten sensitivity. It doesn't matter how much how much mainstream media, how much YouTube videos make fun of non-celiac gluten sensitivity, it is real. Many doctors acknowledge that. There are good scientific papers on it. Not everybody feels sensitive to gluten, and that's, if you're not, that's great. But if every time you eat a food that contains gluten in it and you get a migraine or you have gastrointestinal distress, you don't have to have a celiac disease diagnosis to stop eating gluten. If it makes you feel bad, it's real. Rheumatological and neuromuscular conditions such as mixed connective tissue disease, connective tissue disorders. Again, connective tissue is greatly affected both by mercury and by glyphosate. There was a recent article in the Wise Traditions magazine that just came out a couple weeks ago on glyphosate and collagen, but it doesn't talk about mercury, and it would be really interesting to see those two put together because they both affect collagen very, very much. The overlap of genetic predisposition plus mercury exposure can greatly amplify symptom expression. So again, all of a sudden, in the past couple of decades, there has been a huge explosion of the number and severity of connective tissue disorders. Taking a family history, the previous generations, maybe a connective tissue hereditary tendency towards a connective tissue disorder was expressed as just being very flexible, and in this generation, in the future generation, it was expressed as having debilitating joint problems and musculoskeletal symptoms and neurological symptoms that can sometimes accompany those, and sometimes even cardiovascular symptoms. So this is one of the manifestations of how the accumulation of mercury plus glyphosate, I would add, generation after generation, and in terms of the bioaccumulation in particular of mercury, I don't really know if glyphosate bioaccumulates over the generations or over the lifespan, or I don't really know how that works, but definitely the bioaccumulation of mercury plus the ongoing exposure that almost everybody today has to glyphosate, because it is almost universally used and has been found in, even in the amniotic fluid and cord blood of city dwellers who don't even garden or use Roundup on their own, you know, they don't purchase it. So even if you don't purchase it, you could have large amounts in your body. So this is a big deal for both individual health and public health. And again, this is an area where a lot of people care about it, but there isn't a huge amount of legislation helping the population out. Fibromyalgia is another area where we can see a lot of mercury involvement. Neurological conditions such as Parkinson's and migraines, very different, but nonetheless both neurological conditions, and many others. Cognitive decline, exacerbation of all forms of cognitive decline via accumulation in the brain, impairment of neuron functionality, impairment of glucose regulation, and oxidative stress. Premature aging. So the oxidative damage caused by mercury, and sometimes even the cognitive decline that can happen due to mercury exposure, can be indistinguishable from symptoms of premature aging. Add to that the fact that mercury impairs the regulation of glucose and the way the body responds to insulin. You have another factor that contributes to cognitive decline and to premature aging. So these things compound each other and interact with each other. Digestive disorders, including insufficient hydrochloric acid production, dysbiosis, so you know the wrong combination of the wrong types of microbes in the intestine, small intestinal bacterial overgrowth, SIBO, malabsorption, IBS, parasitic infections, all these things can have a mercury involvement at the cause or as a contributing factor or both. Immune dysfunction, autoimmunity, poor immune function, frequent infections, allergies, mast cell activation syndrome, increased susceptibility to Lyme disease or, you know, delayed healing from Lyme disease, frequent flare-ups in Lyme disease or other illnesses, mold illness, ME/chronic fatigue syndrome, chronic viral infections such as Epstein-Barr virus, and so on, can have mercury toxicity as a contributing factor or as something that made it more easy for a potential illness to become an actual expressed illness. Mitochondrial dysfunction and mitochondrial toxicity to a great extent are mercury driven in many cases. There are other things that can impair mitochondrial function. For example, some antibiotics in the, you know, Cipro, levofloxacin, have been found to be toxic to the mitochondria. And also glyphosate can deplete nutrients that are really important for mitochondrial function. So again, many people are exposed over time to two or all three of these factors, and there are more. Autonomic nervous system dysfunction, such as postural orthostatic tachycardia syndrome, vasovagal syncope, dysautonomia, and so on, can have a mercury toxicity component. Osteoporosis, osteopenia, stress fractures can have a mercury component, and so can endocrine imbalances such as blood sugar regulation, issues, HPA axis problems, thyroid problems, and so on, and much more. So in terms of nutritional needs, mercury exposure increases the need for a nutrient-dense diet for three main reasons. It helps a nutrient-dense diet helps address nutritional depletion that is caused by mercury. It helps repair oxidative damage, and it helps support impaired enzyme systems. You know, we could add to this list, but this is a, you know, it's a survey. Because the nutrient depletion patterns caused by mercury are to a great extent unique to the individual, it is important for bio-individual nutritional support, you know, over a general protocol. That being said, you know, a lot of people with mercury toxicity really benefit from, you know, from a nutritional starting point that may look like the Weston A. Price Foundation's guidelines that you can find in Nourishing Traditions, or, you know, The Practical Paleo is another book that can be incredibly supportive to people suffering from mercury toxicity or with a history of mercury exposure, or really, honestly, any health problems. You know, Weston A. Price Foundation, Nourishing Traditions, you know, a decent paleo diet if you have an autoimmune issue, autoimmune paleo, a lot of good books and resources on that. So these are great starting points, but to fine tune when you feel like you've just hit that wall and you're working so hard and you're just not getting the mileage out of what you're doing, addressing your own bio-individual symptom picture and nutritional needs can be incredibly helpful. Common nutritional needs because of nutrients depleted in mercury-affected people, vitamin C, vitamin E, vitamins A, D, and K, so all the fat-soluble vitamins. Put A, D, and K too together because they work very much as a team. In a lot of mercury-toxic people that have come to me, I've seen isolated high-dose vitamin D supplementation as being incredibly problematic, both in, you know, in a large section of the pediatric and adult mercury poison population. One of the reasons for that is that vitamin D can stay kind of resistantly low and resistant to supplementation because mercury is depleting another essential mineral that would be further depleted by increased levels of vitamin D. So you can't just say, oh, you're low in vitamin D, let's throw some vitamin D at you. It's not really that simple when mercury toxicity is involved, because mercury may have already depleted your magnesium stores to such an extent that supplementing with vitamin D, if you absorb it, drives your magnesium more into the ground, and it can cause a lot of functional problems because the mercury then has a greater toxic effect. So if you're doing, use vitamin D responsibly, that's all I'll say. And be properly tested before you undertake, especially a high dose supplementation. The other thing I will say is in a pediatric population where young children, the younger the child, the smaller the child, the exponentially higher the lead absorption is going to be. And vitamin D supplementation in excess of the child's needs will actually activate the activity of the lead receptors in the small intestines. So inadvertently, by over supplementing or improperly supplementing with vitamin D in a mercury toxic pediatric population, you are setting them up even more, because of the nutritional depletions they already have, to become lead poisoned. And that is just a setup for very bad health problems. I actually have worked with a couple of really severely lead poisoned children from very privileged families who were exposed to just the same amounts of lead as their neighbors. And the reason for the increased toxicity was excessive vitamin D supplementation that was not appropriate to the child because of the nutritional deficiencies and the toxicities they already had previously. So these things can really cause, you know, bring about unwanted consequences, no matter what, you know, how good our intentions are, and no matter how low you may start out in vitamin D, you may need to do the right testing and groundwork to get to the point where you can actually get it up without doing damage to the child. So preparing the groundwork for it to actually be assimilated properly without imbalancing things further, causing more problems than you already had before. Magnesium, potassium, zinc, sometimes copper. This is very complicated, especially the copper piece. The more dysregulated copper is, the more difficult it is to guess whether to supplement with zinc or not. So sometimes people get a little overzealous with their zinc and will cause health problems and sometimes immune dysfunction as a result. So it is important to, you know, zinc and copper, kind of like vitamin D has to be balanced with vitamin A, zinc has to be balanced with copper. It's, you know, a lot more complicated than that, but it's a good start to describe it that way. Zinc and copper can become imbalanced in varying and unpredictable ways. Copper can be dysregulated in many different ways. So it can be high, it can be low, kind of across the board, or you could have high free copper, which is unbound and thus oxidated and toxic to the body, can accumulate in the liver and brain. It is synergistically toxic with mercury. You could at the same time have a copper deficiency because you don't have enough copper that is bound to ceruloplasmin, which is an important copper-dependent iron transport molecule. So you could end up with a kind of secondary iron deficiency anemia that does not properly respond to supplementation. And the underlying cause could be mineral dysregulation caused at the root by mercury, and then you have all these other kind of cogs in the machine that you have to work with and work on. I can stop at any time.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, we may go for another few minutes.
Okay. Yeah. Selenium, lithium, and molybdenum are sometimes also depleted, not always. And sometimes they can actually, you know, it's not good for you to just guess. I'll just take some molybdenum today. It may not be that good for you. It is bio-individual. Vitamin B6, B12, biotin, and other B vitamins are also often depleted. Most people with mercury poisoning do better on a diet that is higher in fats and lower in starches than the standard American diet. So it has to be a nutrient-dense diet. It has to remove, you know, your individual triggers, you know, foods you're sensitive or allergic to or that just set you off, don't make you feel just, you know, quite right. Food sensitivities are more common in mercury toxicity than in the general population. Gluten and casein are kind of at the top of the list. Other common ones are soy, salicylate, free thiols, so a type of sulfur-containing molecule that is, you know, very abundant in cruciferous vegetables, garlic, egg yolks, dairy, and legumes, among others. Free glutamate and oxalate sensitivities are relatively common as well. So, you know, a lot of foods that may look good on paper may not be great healing foods for you right at the beginning of your healing work. There is no perfect test to detect mercury poisoning. You know, 100%, you would basically have to take a biopsy from every type of tissue in the body to have an accurate idea of your actual body burden of mercury. That is not practical, probably not a really good idea, very invasive and painful, and not to mention expensive. Urine challenge tests should be avoided because a chelator can cause oxidative stress, redistribution of mercury, and kidney damage. Not good. Blood, hair, and urine mercury is often low in people with chronic mercury poisoning, so it may show low. You have a chronic mercury burden. You're just not excreting it. Your body has kind of given up because you have run through your natural defenses and your enzyme systems are just not working anymore. You don't have the nutrient power to keep excreting it. That does not mean you are lucky and don't have mercury in your body. That's it's bad news. If properly performed, a porphyrin panel may be helpful. A hair elements test is actually my preferred method of assessing for heavy metal toxicity. It has to be properly interpreted. It's really useless if you're not going to have it properly interpreted. It can reveal patterns of mineral dysregulation associated with mercury toxicity, even when the mercury is not actively excreted in the hair. You can see it from the pattern, you know, from a statistical and probability analysis and from an essential minerals ratio of the way that the essential minerals are behaving versus just looking at the amounts of the toxic elements being excreted in the hair, which is usually not that indicative of what's going on in the body. Cautions, properly remove your amalgam fillings. Don't just run out and get them taken out by the first corner dentist you meet. Same thing goes for mercury detoxification. You should not take chelators lightly. So it definitely should not be taken by anyone who currently has amalgams or other sources of chronic mercury exposure. anyone who's pregnant or breastfeeding or planning to become pregnant, it's not something that you can say, oh, I'll just chelate, and if I become pregnant, I'll just stop. You will be dumping mercury into that baby's body even after you stop chelating for several months. So not a good idea. Chelators include alpha-lipoic acid. Even it doesn't matter what you think you're using it for. If you're using it to lower your blood sugar, it is still acting as a mercury chelator. It crosses a blood-brain barrier. It crosses the cell membrane. It is both water-soluble and fat-soluble. So do not use alpha-lipoic acid if you are pregnant, breastfeeding, or have amalgams. Just not a good idea. And it has to be used responsibly, even if you do not fit into these vulnerable population categories. DMSA, DMPS, and cilantro are also chelators. Again, I don't recommend cilantro to anyone. And DMSA and DMPS would have to be, you know, properly used under the guidance of a licensed practitioner. Chelation is controversial. Frequent low-dose chelation is likely safer than traditional chelation methods. While very popular, chlorella and cilantro supplements may do more harm than good. This is a complicated topic. I find that the most useful ways to address mercury toxicity is really just addressing nutrition and bio-individual nutritional needs via appropriate nutritional choices and appropriate supplementation. I can see the progress in future hair tests. The minerals get more regulated. The toxic metals initially may show as excreting higher, where before they were not being properly excreted, and then over time it will plateau and reduce because you have eliminated the majority of your burden and you have helped your body rebalance its nutrients. So that is all I have to say, and I'm ready for questions.
Great. Thank you for a really information package. So we'll take a few questions. Please wait for me to bring you the microphone. All right, first hand up.
Thank you so much. Please address the reason for chlorella and cilantro supplements doing more harm than good and what type of harm they would do for people taking those.
Sure. So one of the way that cilantro works, and this is just cilantro leaf, it's not coriander seed, is not known. So nobody knows its half-life. Nobody knows exactly what it is in cilantro that is, you know, that is acting as a chelator. So it doesn't seem to me like a really good idea to use something that we don't really know how it works. We just give it on what schedule, and we hope it works. That's not very good science, in my opinion. In terms of chlorella, it's complicated. Chlorella definitely varies very much in terms of quality and contamination levels. So because chlorella does tend to bind to heavy metals, not just mercury, if it's grown in an environment that is that contains heavy metals, it will accumulate those. It has lipopolysaccharides that can be, that can trigger an immune reaction. A lot of people with mercury poisoning have immune problems. So it should not be taken lightly. I know people, I have some colleagues that I like and respect very much who give it to their toddlers. I'm not their practitioner. I'm not going to judge them. I can just say to them, look, go read this article. Think about it again. It's complicated. I don't think that people should just be walking into a store buying chlorella or cilantro and just taking it.
Let's see, there was somebody right here, I thought. Okay, we'll get to you next.
I was wondering why they use mercury in the vaccines. Why, in other words, why is mercury an element of choice for dental applications and for vaccines?
Well,
is there properties that make
sure.
It?
Sure. So in vaccines, it is used for the same reason that it's used in cosmetics and eye drops, ear drops, hemorrhoid creams. It is a preservative. It kills everything, including us, in the right dose. So it is a potent antimicrobial. It's very cheap. It's very toxic. It works because it's toxic. In terms of amalgam, it's really easy for dentists to use it because the temperature temperature fluctuations allow for the dentist to mold mercury into whatever form is needed. So a lot of dentists are resistant to transitioning to composite fillings because they find them a little bit harder to use. It's a convenience issue, essentially.
Omega-3 supplements. I have some that's from Norwegian, some kind of fish. Is there any way to tell what omega-3 would be free for less contaminated with mercury?
Yeah, so most of the reliable supplement companies conduct testing, and they will send you their test results upon request.
I had a rather bizarre accident in the 60s. I was an amateur gold miner. I had a crock of mercury. It was about 20 pounds of liquid mercury in my my bedroom, which was a concrete floor. And the landlady tried to lift it and broke the crock. And I came home that night to an ocean, a shimmering ocean of mercury, which I had to clean up, get back into a container. And then I lived with that for months. It was, you know, I thought I got most of it up, but it was in the carpet, and so I was really a massive exposure to it. But I've had a really healthy life. My blood test doesn't show any abnormalities. I didn't see any of my symptoms up there, so I don't know what effect it actually had.
You may be one of those lucky ones with very robust nutrient status and excellent functional health. You know, if that had happened to me, I don't know what would have happened to me.
Does mercury vaporize if it's yeah, stagnant?
It does, and it enters into the air that we breathe.
Concrete, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So, yeah, I'm glad that nothing worse than that happened to you. Yeah, they should study you. You should contact a scientist and have your genetic.
You may have been 80 IQ points higher had you not had that. Just think how wonderful that might have been.
Hi, thank you for your talk. I had a question about, so like autoimmune disease is so normal now. It's like, I forget the percentage in America, like maybe 70% of people have some form of like autoimmune, candida, IBS, like SIBO, but it's like a lot of my friends have it. And it's like, how do you distinguish between autoimmune and linking to that like mercury toxicity? And like, what's the very first step that you would tell them to like find out like, you know, the difference and like what, like how can they take a first step in order to solve it?
Sure. So that's a really great question. I wouldn't say that it's an issue so much of distinguishing between autoimmune diseases and mercury toxicity or exposure. I would say figuring out what the trigger of the person's onset of their autoimmune disease. They may have a genetic predisposition. Nonetheless, you know, our bodies under the right conditions are robust enough for autoimmune diseases not to be manifested just because we have a predisposition. So one of the questions is, what is the factor or factors that have contributed to this latent possibility being manifested in terms of this specific autoimmune disease? So one of the questions that I do ask in my quest to answer that question is mercury toxicity one of those factors? And I have a list of other things that I'm not going to bore you with right now that I have always in mind as other potential factors. And taking a good history is always the first step. If the person's symptoms, the person's history, the person's condition indicates to me that mercury exposure may be part of that, I will recommend a hair test and properly interpret that test.
Thank you.
What about glutathione and activated charcoal together for removing mercury?
Well, glutathione, if you take it orally, just breaks down into its constituent amino acids in the gut and isn't very helpful. I mean, it may have a placebo effect. People taking glutathione may think, oh, now my glutathione system is going to work. That may help. Placebo effect can be effective. not really much more than that. IV glutathione has adverse effects in some cases, so I, you know, obviously I'm a nutritional therapy practitioner. I would not, you know, recommend that in any sense of the term. But I would discourage, if you were my client or my family member, I would discourage you from seeking IV glutathione treatment because of the risk. I prefer to help nutritionally and supplementally boost the body's ability to create and optimize its glutathione system. So there are a lot of nutrients that can help do that. Even, you know, even supplements like cordyceps or some other of the mushrooms, if they are well tolerated by the person, can help boost the antioxidant system, including glutathione. That would be my preference.
And the charcoal?
The charcoal can be really helpful in an acute situation, so you're preparing for or have just had a mercury amalgam removal. Activated charcoal may be really helpful in the short term. Yeah.
Thanks. We could take maybe one more question, then if anybody else has questions, you can just come down and talk with Sara one-on-one.
You know,
wait for the mic, please.
Often I am just here the second time, and it's a lot to digest, I have to say. However, you know, I just want to, it almost sounds like it's contagious. I mean, really. Does that make sense? I mean, honest
sort
goodness.
Of. Yeah.
Yeah. You know, and I'm noticing, I mean, just amongst our population, the way we relate to each other, the way we do things and what have you, it seems like there's some sort of contagiousness amongst things, mm-hmm. you know, amongst people and all. And so anyway, I just wanted to point that out and ask your opinion.
Well, it definitely, I would say, I may not use the word contagious per se, but I would say there's definitely an epidemic.
An epidemic.
Of unrecognized toxicity.
Yes.
And of illnesses and functional unwellness that is, you know, really endemic in society.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Which is a big alarm thing. And in our society, though, I'm noticing how many people are here. You know, there should be hundreds, which is really amazing. I guess we're too busy or something. But us not. We're not. We're here.
Yeah. I am grateful to Thanks. Every single person who is here.
Yes. You recommended activated charcoal from recent mercury exposure. What kind of mercury exposure are you talking about that activated charcoal is good
sure,
for
so,
all of them or amalgam?
Well, you know, if you're consuming high mercury fish, I would say just don't consume them. I don't really think that activated charcoal will really make up for having the big, you know, king mackerel or swordfish plate. I would say, you know, if you are going in to get your amalgams removed, you could consider taking activated charcoal for, you know, for a couple of weeks while you're doing that. With everything else, you know, maybe you just got exposed to, you know, to a broken compact fluorescent light bulb in your home. You may want to, you know, seal off that room, get that properly cleaned up to the greatest extent possible, move if you can, and, you know, aerate the place, you know, so at least as much of that is gone before the next tenant comes in.
And how much activated charcoal?
You know, just follow the directions on the package. It's usually, you know, like 1 to 3 capsules a day for, I would say, a couple of weeks if, you know, if you've had an acute exposure.
You want to ask one more in front of the group? Okay.
Does mercury accumulate in the bones as children grow if they're exposed to it as children?
So the bone tissue is a tissue that preferentially accumulates lead and cadmium versus necessarily large amounts of mercury. It's the brain tissue, the organs and glands, and the barriers that are more susceptible to mercury accumulation, not so much the bone per se. Yeah. Yeah.
So let's say, please thank Sara once again for her talk. And she will be around for a few minutes
yes.
to answer questions, but she does have to take off to get back to
Berkeley
to
my 5-year-old son,
who
has a bedtime.
But I do hope. So thank you. I do hope most people will stay around. Our talk after the break. We'll take one shortly.